Good afternoon to our comrades in the party. I convene a greeting to you by my half and Ambassador Jesus Manzanilla, who asking me to convey a fraternal greeting to the Secretary General of the party, Benedict Wachaira, and the Vice President Booker, and to the rest of the Bureau. Thank you for the invitation and for your brotherhood and solidarity with Venezuela, with my people. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Red salute. I feel so young today. You know, we in India are not so used to such lively things, you know. I became a communist long time ago while I was studying in the Southeast Asia under the influence of the Vietnamese guys. Much of what they speak, I did not understand. But much of what they did, I did understand. You know, communists are known for doing and not for what they speak. What we speak, we do. You know, when I came back to India, I joined the Communist Party of India, worked for the peasants. And I worked for so many years working for the peasants. I tell you, as the Youth Communist League, you people have a great future. We are in the business of liberation. We are in the business of bringing people out of all kinds of oppression. You know, you have a great future. This country has a great future. When I see young kids like you with the great minds, I see the future of this country. I see the future of this country because there is young blood who is willing to strive, willing to struggle, willing to create a revolution in this country. And I believe it's only the youth that can change. As you grow old, we grow in wisdom. But the youth is what who can act. And when you do act, you change. And I am here to, I did not know that I was going to speak to such young minds. You know, when I see you, I see talent, I see energy. You look at all the talent and energy which is being pooled on the favor of the bourgeois. And you look at you, looking and standing in the favor of the oppressed, the favor of the working class. I tell you, you have the future. This country, I traveled a little bit down the coast and back to Nairobi. I see oppression. I see poverty. I see people who are educated but illiterate. They know how to read, but they have lost all kinds of wisdom. I tried to reason out. I met some county assembly members back in, what is this place? Kwale. Right? What they think, how they think, is not in favor of the oppression. There is a bankruptcy of wisdom. I don't know what they're doing. I don't even know how people even vote for such people. You see? You need, I see you people as the future leaders of this country. You have all the brains, all the wisdom, and all the vision to go ahead. Do not lose heart. Do not lose your way. You start young, you continue till the end. I see the chairperson, I look at my senior comrades. They're not very different. You know, in my party, we classify those guys who have gone to the prison. We number the stripes on our bodies. You know? We number the stripes on our bodies. That gives us the stripes on our chest. You know, this fight, we fight against the oppressors is not an easy way. We are going to be picked up, put into prisons. We are going to vanish. Many of my comrades have vanished. We have not seen them. In the name of terrorism, in the name of national interest, in the name of all kinds of funny stuff, they keep disappearing. I'm telling you, the way you have selected is not an easy way. It's a tough way. Are we willing to count our stripes as our glory? Is that going to glorify us? Are we going to take the tough stuff, steps ahead? This is communism. This is where we stand. We stand under, until death, we stand in the favor of those people who are oppressed, voiceless, marginalized. We look on a continuous quest to liberate them. Friends, there is a great advantage of comradehood. You know, there is no other party who calls their fellow party men as comrades. I'm from India. I come here. I address you guys, comrades. Back in India, we are also called comrades. You go to Sri Lanka, they call us comrades. You go to Tanzania, they call us comrades. Why? There's a big comradeship. We are a part of the world comradeship, world fraternity. Because what issues that face in Kenya is the same what faces in other parts of the country. You think that developed nations do not face these problems? They too face the same kind of problems. There is an increasing trend of homelessness. There is an increasing trend of poverty, even in developed nations. There is a big opportunity of world comradeship. I sit here, I don't find myself any way out of place except your dancing and singing. Otherwise, I feel so comfortable here. You see, and I'm telling you, when you come back to India, when you come to India and you visit some of my party units, you will feel that it's the same. We're under the same culture of Marxism. We are under the same culture of communism, which has brought us up from the youth. And now we are graying. And while we gray, we try to encourage and build young minds like you. I wish you all the best. Don't lose heart. You have a great future. And this country is truly blessed but by young minds and young blood like you. Thank you so much.
Viva CPK, viva!
Viva!
I'm very much humbled to be invited to this event. I'm very much humbled to see my chair, Comrade Mwandawiro Muganga. I can humbly say that I'm a product of the Communist Party, and this is a party that really invested a lot of resources and energy in shaping me to whom I've become. The Secretary General of the party might not be around, but he is a man that really inspired young cadres and a lot of them to become what they are in this country today. One thing that I can say to the youths who are here in this space, that you're in the right space. Even if you see other youths, young people rally behind those crazy politicians with backward ideas, empty ideas and everything, I can assure you and guarantee you that today you're in the right space. And my message is very clear that the Communist Party is a party that has withstood the test of time. Clearly, this is a party that the government of Kenya has really tried hard to fight it. The government has come with all forces, with all forms of militancy, and recently we saw the government bombarding their offices with tear gas and bullets and everything. But it's evident that this party has withstood the test of time. Comrade Mwandawiro is here to attest. that he was tortured, he was arrested, he was detained, and he was done all manner of things that were never done to Raila Odinga. Yet Raila Odinga is stupidly calling himself the father of democracy, but he never went through what Mondairo went through. Raila Odinga never had an ideological stand, and up to date, he doesn't have even have an ideological stand. And today, we say that the Communist Party has stood the test of time, and if there is a home that the youths want to liberate this country, seek and yearn to be, then this is the right home. Invest your little resources in this party, invest in this space and everything. My message is very clear to the so-called sector called the civil society. And my message to the civil society is that the Communist Party is not an enemy. If the civil society in this country truly stands for change, truly stands for liberation of this country, and has an ideological and wants to reform this country, then those peaceful reforms, disjointed reforms, where we want to reform the judiciary separately, we want to reform the police separately, someone wants to reform the county government, someone wants to reform what? We are not going anywhere with those piecemeal reforms. We are not going with reforms that can be documented and reported in terms of budget, Gini and everything. We can only reform this country. This country is in a mess. This country is in a... Any country may fika mahali. If it can only be liberated, then we can only change the systems. Total revolution. From the capitalist system, from the backward capitalist system, to the communist system, and the Communist Party is the only party that is ideologically standing. The narrative of the working class is very alive, and you can see that there is one politician who understands clearly the narrative of the working class, who understands the pain of the working class. Not that he wants to liberate the working class, but he wants to ride on the tide of the working class as a wave. And today he comes with the tools of the working class and the narrative of the working class, pretending that he's the messiah. Wheelbarrows. Okay, we are saying that we without mocking the tools of the working class, without mocking the sickle and the hammer and any other tool that the working class uses, we are saying to the people in UDA that please stop riding on the ideology of the working class. If you truly mean well for this country, then commit class suicide. First of all, disown the wealth that you stole. First of all, come to the public. Let the public hang you for the corruptions that you did, for the torture that you did, for the organizing to torture and arrest people under the Nyayo era. Ruto, come, we cleanse you, we torture you, we take you through study circles and deep cells, we indoctrinate you and give you time to observe you. Then you can come and claim that you stand for the working class and you represent the working class. Otherwise, riding on the tide of the working class, we are saying that you're ni uongo, and the only party that stands for the rights of the working class is this party. As I finish, I want to say that the social justice centers must not look at CPK as an enemy. And there must not be any rift between the social justice centers and the CPK. And if anything, as we go to the election, if social justice centers mean well for this country, then their centers should be the hub for the aspirants. If we have a social justice center in Mathare, like now we have 4 in Mathare, and we have a candidate in Mathare, then they must be able and be in a position to dispose all their resources to our candidates in Mathare, to the center and everything. And so we need to create that. And to our members who are within the centers and still organizing at the party, we want to make it open and we want to create a synergy so that we see how best you are going forward. This country needs an ideological leadership. That one is clearly lacking, and I thank the party. The party has really grown, the country has really transformed, and we can see the revolutionary culture being manifested in a massive way. Comrade Chair, you are not there when I arrived, but there is a cell called Mau Mau, and this cell is very, very, very strong. It was vibrant when they came here and their chants and everything. I can say that the state even trembled. I think this is that's a cell that must be given all revolutionary duties roles to chant, to leaders in chanting and everything, and even to welcome the chair or even welcome the ambassador of Venezuela. Without much, nasema nimefurahia. And above all, I've liked the way the party has taken the struggle out of Nairobi. And this is why I'm saying most of these struggles done by the civil societies and NGOs claim to be left, but not left. are centered within the city for populism and publicity. But the CPK has taken the struggle outside Nairobi. I saw them organize in Mombasa, trying to create a united democratic front. And I saw CPK, whatever they're doing in game, and radicalizing the masses and telling them that even your very own, you know, this country is so much divided into along tribal lines that people don't think that their tribal, their own tribe can produce corrupt leaders and theft and everything. And what Comrade Buka is doing in game is very much commendable. I stand with the party and I support the party. I'm also a member of the online cell. Together with Brian and Comrade Wahome, we've been doing some studies, and soon we'll be visiting the party headquarters, and we thank the party for organizing this. Viva YSL, viva!
Viva!
Viva YCL, viva!
Viva CPK, viva! My name is Moivu Wakaluka from Taita Taveta, and I would like to thank the organizers of this event for giving me an opportunity to speak on the role of the youth, our revolutionary task. And we know that every generation has to rewrite its own history. So comrades, we must ask ourselves different questions to arrive at better answers, because every objective thing is subject to change. And to deny change is like to deny dialectics and fall into the metaphysical world where we see things as isolated or static, or we see things as immutable. So today, the youths of Africa and all the youths of the third world country are facing new challenges. And we cannot address these challenges without looking at the at new colonialism, looking at capitalism, looking at imperialism, and looking at globalized neoliberalism. And we can see that when Marx was analyzing the laws of the development of the previous modes of production, he did not say that what he had written or what he had said was a closed book. As Marxists, or the soul of Marxism is to do concrete analysis in every concrete situation. So in every day in our struggle, we must do social investigation in every situation. We can also see that when Marx was analyzing the laws of development of capitalism, he saw that there was tendency of concentration and centralization of capital. And this even Lenin came to prove later when he was developing the theory of imperialism, because after the industrial crisis in Europe, he saw that these industries were coming together. They were concentrating their capital for the continual domination of the working class. So we can see that Lenin was able to trace that development very precisely from the end of 19th century to the beginning of the 20th century. And we can see that after these bourgeois came together so that they could make more profit and continue their domination, they were faced with the challenge of overproduction and underproduction. So they had to go to other parts of the world to seek for cheap labor, to seek for raw materials. And this is where we saw colonialism and imperialism. And even in the 21st century, we saw that these bourgeois, these exact nations, they could not continue competing because this was against the realization of their profits. So they still had to come together. So after the World War I and the World War II, they still had to concentrate again. They could not compete for domination of the world. So, and we had the famous Bretton Woods Institution, or the Bretton Woods Conference, that these industrialized advanced countries came together to continue concentrating and centralizing their capital. So this was, again, Marx was being vindicated. And then, but it was until the 1973 oil embargo and the debt crisis in Europe that they had to use the instrumentality of the IMF and the World Bank to continue their domination. Again, we can see they are still concentrating and centralizing their capital. So this made them to use the instrumentality of the IMF and the World Bank, and we saw that they prescribed what they call the structural adjustment programs to many African countries. And we can see even today that these structural adjustment programs have failed. They've really caused economic havoc to our African economies and countries of the third world. and also the uneven development between the center and the periphery countries. So we can see that even today in my organizing in Taita, while I was growing some tomatoes, I do farming, I was able to witness or to come into contact with the neoliberalism, from buying the seeds, from buying fertilizers. Even when we get to the market, when we get our products to the market, we can see that the illusions of free market is just an illusion. And even the concept of the invisible hand of demand and supply, that's just cheap deception. We are just controlled by a rogue of cartels. And I was able to also see that neoliberalism has affected us, the youth, in fact. We can see the rate of unemployment. It's unbearable in Kenya. So the revolutionary task of the youth today is to try and organize, to try and mobilize, and to try and raise the political consciousness of the working masses. And what is the answer to all these systems of oppression that I've tried to highlight? The only answer to these systems of oppression is socialism. Socialism is inevitable. So in our organizing, we must try to organize, to mobilize around our social spaces, whether it's in the schools, whether it is in the factories, whether it is in anywhere we must organize as the youth. That is our revolutionary task. And we must also ensure that we try and marry the theory of the revolution and the practice. Because if you rely too much on theory, then we will fall into subjectivism or dogmatism. We must marry it with the practice. And also, we should not also concentrate too much on the practice and become complacent in reading theory. We must also read theory so that we don't commit some empiricist errors. So that is the revolutionary task of the youth today. Thank you, comrades, for your time.
When you cross the Ghana River to write history with fire and blood, reject the myths and lies of our past, reject the madness of Nyayism, follow the Mau Mau heroism, follow Mao and Ho Chi Minh, Castro and Che, follow Kemathi. Nifupi tu, asanteni. So
the poem is My Stand, and it was written on 4th June 1988 at Kibos Main Prison. So did you say, if I continue with this stand, which is of truth and justice, I will die poor, propertyless? But I tell you so that you be knowing, I am explaining so that you keep on remembering. I do not value that sort of wealth, the wealth that comes from exploitation, the wealth that arises from betrayal and opportunism. I am not tempted by that sort of wealth. Amidst a large ocean of poverty, to me that is not wealth. It has no meaning. The wealth I look forward
to. I will choose to remain faithful to this document by first of all actually emphasizing that there is no magic that can make one become a member of the Young Communist League. Because there are a lot of things there that Comrade Lenin has actually highlighted in terms of one who can be a member of the Young Communist League. And also in the document, we are also seeing a case where the Young Communist League and its component, that is the youth, is not a monolithic entity. And when you are analyzing the youth, then you can't say the youth as a population is a single homogeneous unit. And also in the document, we are also seeing the significant role of the young people in terms of advancing change in various parts of the world. But also to note, comrades, is what Lenin has talked about in terms of truth, because there are a lot of things running in the system of capitalism. But even in Kenya, the contradictions in the system are so naked. But the agents and the sympathizers want to present truth in clothes, which every time misleads young people in terms of advancing and organizing the party. But Comrade Lenin talks about one of the most general thing and the task the Young Communist League must actually take note of, and that is to be ready to learn. And learning here is actually learning the theory of Marxism and not in the way Comrade Brown was putting it, just as wrote in wrote form, but in terms of analyzing it concretely and actually very well in terms of its application in the Kenyan political space. And in fact, in terms of learning the ideas of communism, then Young Communist League must insist on the scientific aspect of that literature. And that is Marxism as actually advanced by various comrades, including Comrade Karl Marx. But on that note still, then you find the story of Karl Marx was a young person who was inspired by nothing but the conditions in his country. And at that age, actually Karl Marx was actually seeing oppression. And back to Comrade Fidel, then we are seeing a young boy who actually rose up and mobilized fellow young people. And in the story of actually Fidel, you also see the aspect of young people and their role. In terms of, you know, attack on Moncado barracks, you also see the role of those people in the anti-Batista struggle. They are young people. There were no people who were actually out of the sky. But there were young people in those countries, people who wanted change and genuine change. And they actually won the struggle. And today, Cuba remains an example, a global example of socialist experiment. But people who praise Cuba as young people must also ask themselves, what young people in those parts of the in that part of the country, of the world, played to actually realize socialism and construction of socialism towards communism in Cuba. And also in the document by Comrade Lenin, then the idea of analyzing such conditions actually comes very clearly. That those who read Marxism must actually free themselves from the guilt of looking at Marxism in isolation. That people want just to read and sound like they are geniuses in the society. And people who also want to read theory but divorce from themselves from practical work on ground. And in fact, what makes Young Communist League a Marxist organization and playing its role in Kenya as a machinery for the party in terms of organization, recruitment, and training is when comrades can learn the ideas of Marxism in totality and not in isolation. Then Young Communist League in that regard can play a key role in terms of advancing what we are saying a socialist revolution here in Kenya. And also to note in terms of what Comrade Lina has talked about is about sharpening contradictions in the system. Because we are seeing a case where, like in the Kenyan situation, the youth, every time the media wants to analyze the youth in terms of, you know, in wholesale manner, that young people are uniform and the youth is a tribe on its own. But you also see in terms of analysis of this document, what Comrade Lenin actually talks about in the document is in terms of what are the different stratas of the society acquiring in terms of knowledge. Because we have people from the, you know, the bourgeois strata, and we have young people from actually the poor strata in the society. And these two people are too different and are actually very different and antagonistic in that regard. And therefore, Young Communist League must also take it up to the task to actually expose and sharpen the contradictions, for example, here in Kenya, by forever, every time, turning their hunger against the system and organizing for the alternative that is socialism and ultimately communism here in Kenya. That is what actually Comrade Lenin actually analyzes in the document. But before I continue, I'll be finishing in a few minutes. We also see there are comrades globally, like Comrade Lenin. I have read their stories, and they are not people who just were born revolutionaries. But they were young people who were actually doing some theoretical research and actually also being inspired by conditions in their country. The poverty, the suffering, the insecurity, the depression, and all manner of actually suffering that the other pole in the society actually receives every time. And also in this document, we are also seeing the question of morality and culture in terms of the Young Communist League. That morality also bears what we call a class character. And people can tell us about universal morality in the Young Communist League. And also to talk about culture, then Lenin actually brings the example very clearly. That in terms of looking at morality here, then people tell us, you know, before God, we are all equal. And you can only use the commandments of God in terms of what the poor and the rich in this country can adhere to. Then we are saying the morality that is mostly run in the bourgeois arrangement is that one that is to keep the poor people and the working class actually submissive to one predator class in the society and in Kenya, the capitalist in Kenya here. Then Comrade Lenin actually continues by still appreciating what is actually calling the kind of education that young people in this kind of society also are entitled to. Because in terms of education, then we should be having a kind of education that inspires science in the young people. But we are having a system in Kenya that is consciously indoctrinating people to actually acquire and assimilate the bourgeois propaganda. And we are seeing young people growing, praising the system of capitalism. But as the Young Communist League, then we must agree that the young people from the poor strata are victims of the system, and they are not capitalists themselves. And every time, we must remind young people who are out here that the youths in Kenya are victims of capitalism, and they are not victors of capitalism. So what they must do is to rise to the task, to organize the people, to train and to recruit people in this journey of building a socialist party and ultimately building a communist country here in Kenya. We believe that in our lifetime, it can be achieved if we play our part honestly in terms of organization. Death. And to conclude my analysis of what Comrade Lenin talked about is in terms of the composition of YCL. That YCL has people that come from different strata, as I said, but there is need for those young people in the Communist League to actually remind themselves of the task they are having in terms of advancing it further. Because this document talks about, you know, the free youth in the Russia, the people who have actually actualized socialist revolution and are building it towards communism. But in terms of this document also, to bring it home in Kenya, then people who are in the Young Communist League must actually adhere to what we are saying, an honest struggle which may be long, but ultimately we can win it in our lifetime. That is my analysis of the document, comrades, and I want to stop it at that moment.
More power to continue organizing, basing on our ideological works of Walter Rodney. And Walter Rodney's paper, A History of Upper Guinea Coast, paved a very huge way for Rodney's works, because he was writing on African history in the lenses of an African oppressed people and a marginalized population outside the university. As a student, Walter Rodney felt the disconnect between his life and knowledge in campus and the grassroots oppressed and marginalized population outside of that university. In 1968, when Walter Rodney was appointed to teach at the Dar es Salaam University in Tanzania, he participated actively in debates and used to hold impromptu historical lessons and organize Sundays with Rodney, which, according to a visit with senior comrade Kamonya Manji, were lively sessions and made them persons, or the persons that they are. While lecturing at Tanzania and West Indies, Walter Rodney and his scholarship trained a generation of future Marxists and Pan-Africanists.